Let me just share my screen really quickly. And we will get started. All right, so good morning, everybody. And I just want to quickly welcome you all to this morning's second presentation on museums in the digital age, continuing with virtual programming and online content 1 year later. Before I actually begin this presentation, I do want to introduce myself and thank everybody for joining in and attending this session with me. It is actually quite exciting to be able to be here and talk about this particular topic with all of you. My name is Chris O'Brien, and as you can see on this slide here, this is my dog, Luna, and I'm one of the Visitor Services Associates at the Railroad Museum of Pennsylvania. I've been working in the museum field since graduating Millersville University in 2014. I interned at the Daniel Boone Homestead after graduating, and then I worked at Eastern State Penitentiary before coming to the Railroad Museum. Now, why am I up here speaking to you all about developing, creating, and getting started with virtual programs rather than our director or one of our educators? Mainly because as we closed down due to the pandemic in 2020, I began to work closely with our director, our educators, and the rest of our visitor services staff in potentially creating videos to post on YouTube and other social media sites, as well as trying to figure out how we could potentially stream our tours and educational programs from home. In a sense, I was really trying to spearhead this initiative of going virtual. As we started to go forward with this idea, I began to take on additional responsibilities in filming our videos, editing them together, and producing these in-house videos and programs for the museum. If you took a look at our catalog of videos and virtual programs that we put together over the past 2 years, I think I put together or edited roughly 90, 95% of those. So it's been a lot of work over the past 2 years to get our virtual programming and online content up and running. And that's what this particular presentation is all about. To begin, I do want to go over the experiences that we had at Railroad Museum with getting started with our own virtual programs and creating our own online content. I'll also go over how and why we started, how our content and programs evolved over time, why we continued with these programs even after reopening to the public, and the challenges and obstacles that we faced, how we overcame them, and the lessons that we learned. After sharing those experiences, I'll also be talking about how everyone here today can get started with your own virtual programs and online content, the available resources out there for free and low cost, and finally, the benefits that will come about from creating this kind of content and why you should continue to do so even after being reopened to the public. So why do we begin? And what did we use when we were first starting out? Like many of you, we were told that we were going to be closing down for about 2 weeks in March of 2020. As we all know, those 2 weeks turned into a month, which turned into 6 months. And before we knew it, we at the Railroad Museum were closed down for a good 14 months before we were allowed to reopen. So being closed down during the pandemic forced us to look at our programming differently. How do we share our programs and tours with our visitors as museums? How do visitors access our museum, our programming, and our collections when we're all closed down? How does visitor services staff, such as myself, work from home when our primary duty is visitor interaction? It's certainly difficult, but as someone who spent a lot of time on social media sites, in different video game communities, and just browsing around on YouTube, following different YouTube creators, I saw the potential for Railroad Museum in creating online videos and somehow streaming our programs virtually and really helped us in getting this idea off the ground. Unsure when we were going to be reopened, if we were going to be reopened anytime soon, I began working on creating essentially a glorified slideshow of our museum over top of me narrating who we are, when we came about, and what we have in our collection, as well as what you as a visitor would expect to see. This became our very first video of the pandemic and really got us started in creating virtual content and taking this idea a little bit more seriously. We kept creating videos throughout April and May, and in May, we did our first virtual program, a Zoom presentation for a Boy Scout troop in Louisiana that was on our Working on the Railroad school tour that we initially developed for giving in person to school groups. And we adapted to a virtual program for this Boy Scout troop. As we became more familiar with Zoom and adapting our in-person tours to be presented virtually, we finally decided to go a step further in August by creating a program that was specifically meant to be presented virtually. This was our Dawn of the Diesels behind the scenes tour of our equipment. For this program, our staff simply took our phones inside different pieces, talked about the history of the piece while streaming parts of the engine that our visitors typically don't get to see on a daily basis. And then finally, by September, we began to collaborate with other PHMC sites with a sports-themed happy hour program, along with adapting our Heritage Day special event to be done entirely virtually, which we did with a series of lectures over Zoom. Since starting in March 2 years ago, we have done roughly 55 to 60 virtual programs, if not more, and put out around 45 to 50 online videos to YouTube and social media. Now, the equipment that we used in the very beginning was pretty basic. We were using personal camcorders, DSLR cameras, smartphones, personal microphones, free video editing software like Shotcut and Audacity, as well as my own personal copy of Sony Vegas. As we did more and more videos and began making these videos a bit more complex in terms of editing and production, we looked into getting better equipment. Fortunately, through a grant, we were able to purchase much better equipment than we were using at the very start of the pandemic. We were now using higher quality camcorders, tripods and stabilizers, lavalier and on-camera microphones, as well as some lighting equipment for these programs and for our videos. However, at the same time, we were still using free video editing software, as well as my own personal copy of Sony Vegas, simply because these were the programs that were working for us. Over time, as we created more and more videos, we were getting more proficient and more skilled at putting them together. We knew how we wanted these videos to look, and as such, they were now taking a lot less time to put together than they once did. Now, these two videos that I'm going to show you were both produced nearly a year apart. They're both about 30-second clips, and they were put together by our collections and archives managers for our yearly Barons and Builders summer camp on the topic of what goes on when working in the archives and collections area of a museum. The first clip that I'm going to show you was put together using a smartphone and very basic video editing software, while the second clip was put together using the equipment that we got from the grant, along with the knowledge and the skills that we learned over the course of 1 year creating this content.
Welcome to the Railroad Museum of Pennsylvania. Most people only see the public spaces, but today we're going to give you a peek behind the scenes.
Hi, I'm Dodie Robbins, the Collections Manager at the Railroad Museum of Pennsylvania.
And I'm Lauren Radkiewicz, the Archives Technician at the Railroad Museum of Pennsylvania.
The Railroad Museum of Pennsylvania collects objects that are very big, objects that are very small, and objects of every size in between.
At the Railroad Museum of Pennsylvania, we collect artifacts and archival materials that relate to the railroading industry in Pennsylvania. Our mission is to preserve and interpret the Commonwealth's rich railroad history, to engage a broad and diverse audience, and to educate the public about the role railroads played, past and present, in building our nation and shaping our daily lives.
Now, in the first clip, you could see that Dodie and Lauren were narrating behind their phones and were using the built-in microphone to record their audio. They were also shooting the footage by hand and did not really have a tripod or any kind of stabilizer to get still footage. In the second clip, Dodie and Lauren are now using a tripod to stabilize their footage from a camcorder. They were recording their audio separately and then using B-roll footage to enhance what they were talking about. And as I'll discuss later, it's not so much about what you use to record and to create your videos with, but rather the care that you put into creating these videos and the content that is being presented. Could you recreate the video on the right while using the equipment that was used for the video on the left? Absolutely. I have no doubt in my mind that you could do that. But the differences between these two videos is not exactly what was used, as both were produced using the same video editing software, but rather the knowledge that we learned over time while creating these videos.
At the railroad.
Now, when we were closed down for 14 months before being allowed to reopen. And when we were told that we would be reopening, we had to decide if we wanted to continue creating these videos and these virtual programs or not. So why did we decide to continue? Well, we decided to do so for a couple of reasons. The biggest reason is that by creating this kind of content, putting videos online, hosting virtual programs, we were becoming more accessible to those outside our communities and to those who could not visit our museum or experience our in-person programming for one reason or another. And we weren't just becoming more accessible to those who couldn't visit, but more accessible overall, even to those who could visit. During the winter, when our visitation slows down, we could work on creating informational videos to enhance our accessibility. Videos like a know before you go or a point of view walkthrough video of the site to give our visitors a sense of what admission is going to entail and what to expect when planning a visit. It also gives us a chance to work with other organizations. Next month, we have planned a tour with the fine folks up at the Warnersville train station who've agreed to allow us to film inside and to talk to us about their station and their restoration efforts. This collaboration not only helps us in continuing to tell the story of railroading in Pennsylvania, but also helps them in reaching new audiences to get their story told and gives them something to share online as well. Now, it wasn't always sunshine and rainbows in getting started with our virtual programs or our online content. In fact, it wasn't even all that easy in the very beginning when we were just starting out and trying to figure out what we wanted to do and where to go. There were plenty of challenges and obstacles that we ran into, both very, very minor ones and very, very major ones, along with some obstacles that we honestly never even accounted for or expected. The next few slides, I'll be talking about some of the larger obstacles that we faced as we were getting started and the lessons that we took from them. Now, I can't feasibly go over every single challenge or obstacle that we faced, especially when starting out. Otherwise, we'd be here all day. But the three I do want to talk about are the ones that we took the biggest lessons from. These three obstacles could be ones that you face if you decide to start creating your own virtual programs, or might be ones that you are currently facing if you are already working on this. For us, the three biggest challenges that we took the biggest lessons from are realizing that not every program will be a success, figuring out what pricing model and time of day works best for our virtual programs, and finally, utilizing your time wisely. In other words, time management, especially if this is something that you plan on doing while being reopened. Now, understanding that not every Zoom program that we did would be a success was one of our biggest lessons to be learned. One of our early programs that we did was called A Few of Our Favorite Things Happy Hour, with the idea that each staff member was going to present their favorite artifact in the museum. A lot of us were very excited for this program. And unfortunately, only one person attended, our archives manager's grandmother. So what did we do? No, we still held the program. Why? Well, at the time, we were just still getting started with virtual programs, and this gave us some valuable practice and a chance to learn how we could improve our programs going forward. We learned that just because we might be excited to put on a specific program doesn't mean that our audience will share that excitement or that they would be interested in that particular topic. and that not everything that we do will be an immediate success. Even if you fail, there is no reason to quit. Failure is oftentimes the best teacher. So reflect on why that program didn't work out and improve on the next one. For this program, we realized that this was more of a seasonal program to do around the holidays, not in the middle of summer. And that for these kinds of programs, we should have a more clear and engaging theme for the audience while giving it a name that doesn't alienate or eliminate a family atmosphere as we've done with this particular program. Our next biggest obstacle was figuring out the best pricing model for our programs and the best time of day to put them on. Do we make the programs donation only? Do we set a fixed ticket price like admission to the museum? What time of day works the best? What combination will get us the best outcome of income and attendance? And this might seem like a minor problem, but one of the reasons why that happy hour may have been so unsuccessful was due to the time of day that we were hosting it. We were hosting a happy hour at 7 p.m. on a Wednesday night in the middle of summer with a holiday theme to it. So to really address this problem, especially at the very beginning, was to simply try a day and time to see what works and test out different days of the week and different times. Sometimes the program was a hit and sold out. Other times we only had a handful of attendees, and that was okay. To add on to that issue, and this is something I'll talk a little more about later on, was pricing. What do we charge for these events? Do we even charge for them? In the very beginning, we were charging $5 per screen for our Zoom programs. Over time, as we did more of these, we were finding out that even when our programs sold out, there was always a cap to how much income we could make off a Zoom program. We could have raised the prices, but we feared that we would lose attendance. So what we ended up doing was switching to a pay what you wish donation model. This allowed those who were attending to pay what they thought the program was worth to them and allowed more people to experience our programming as it was now more affordable. In the end, we ended up with more people attending on average, along with seeing an increase in income per event over the fixed $5 rate. And finally, the last big obstacle that in some respects we're still dealing with today is time management. This is an obstacle that we really didn't encounter until after reopening. During the closure period, our only visitor interaction was through these virtual programs that we were putting on. Creating these videos and presenting these programs were our focus. And when we reopened, we had to adjust our expectations and our priorities. We were still committed to working on virtual programs and videos. But by being reopened, it meant that we were now expected to resume our in-person visitor interactions, to interpret our pieces of equipment, to give tours, to run the desk, clean, and to do everything else that we couldn't do by being closed. So now, our obstacle was managing our time. We had to resume our pre-COVID duties while balancing out our post-COVID duties with video work. And this was not always easy, especially since we do not really have a full dedicated social media staff. The two departments doing the most of this work, if not all of it, at Railroad have been our education and our visitor services departments. However, being reopened and resuming our duties at the museum meant that our time to work on and produce these programs and videos was cut down significantly. For us to continue with our virtual work, we now had to find the time to do so. And it wasn't just finding the time to record or to edit, but to research the topic, to write the video, to bring out any artifacts that we were highlighting, and to market and advertise these programs if need be. Fortunately for us, as we came back to reopen, we adjusted and changed our hours of operations and schedule. Instead of being open 7 days a week, 9 to 5, we were now open 5 days a week, 10 to 4. This change not only allowed us at the museum to better clean the museum in the morning and the afternoon, but by being closed 2 days a week, allowed us to work on projects that we would never have been able to do had we been open. Projects like virtual programs and online content. Now, changing your hours may not always be a possibility. But learning time management and utilizing the time that you do have to its fullest potential is such an important lesson and skill to learn. So, what does it take to get started? You've heard our experiences with creating virtual content at the Railroad Museum, and you all might be very well interested in what it takes to get started in creating online content and virtual programs of your very own. So let's talk about that. But before you can really get started, I want you all to ask yourselves a couple of questions. These three questions in particular. Why do you want to get started with virtual programming and online content? Why now? What is stopping you from getting started? What obstacles are in your way? In short, what challenges are preventing you from getting started? And finally, what do you wish to accomplish by creating virtual programs? Now, these questions don't need to be answered right now or right away, but keep them in the back of your head for the rest of this presentation and talk about them with your staff afterwards. See what their opinions and answers are. Because once you can answer these questions, you'll have a good direction of where to go when starting your journey in creating these programs for your site and a good idea of what you want these programs to look like. Now, I've been using the terms virtual programs and online content seemingly interchangeably throughout this presentation. But what do they really mean? These are two very vague terms that could almost mean the same thing. But we at Railroad looked at them as two different concepts. So let's take a quick look at the differences of these concepts, as this difference will also help you in creating the type of content that you want to do. A virtual program will be an adaptation of an existing program that you may have already created for your site, or something entirely new created specifically for virtual presentation. They're typically going to be presented live in front of virtual audiences, very much similar to this conference. They'll allow for Q&A and discussion at the very end or throughout the presentation. They can be recorded to be shared later and usually run for an extended period of time, usually about 30 minutes or more. At the Railroad Museum, some virtual programs that we've done include things like a trivia night, behind the scenes tours, curator talks, or even adapting an existing program for virtual audiences, like our Working on the Railroad school tour program. Online content, on the other hand, are going to be pre-recorded videos. They're more for spotlighting inaccessible parts of your museum or highlighting an artifact, exhibit, or display. They can be shared to social media almost instantaneously. They can be shared in email blasts to all of your members or newsletters. They can be used for in-house purposes or even used as special member benefits. And they'll typically run shorter in length. I think all the videos that we produce for our online content have been no more than really 5 or 6 minutes long. And some of the examples that we've done for online content at the museum include things like highlight or spotlight videos, introductory or virtual tour videos, personalized videos for our Adopt-A-Train fundraiser, in-house know before you go and walkthrough videos, or even creating a mock commercial for one of our passenger cars that I'll show you in the next slide. Now, this particular video was originally done for a virtual collections showcase that was hosted by the PHMC on the topic of travel. With the help of our staff, we put together a little ad, if you will, for one of our passenger cars, the Pullman Lotus Club. And I think this is a great example of some of the things that you could do with online content or for in-house use. And all it takes is a little bit of creativity and imagination. And with that, this is what we managed to come up with for our own mock commercial.
Traveling for business? Going on vacation? Why not travel in comfort on the Lotus Club? Roomy seating during the day turns into comfortable sleeping sections during the night, so you can get the rest you need. There are both a women's room and a men's room to tidy up and get ready for dinner or bedtime. Our tiny yet fully equipped kitchen will serve you delicious refreshments and meals. enjoy a meal or kick back, read the paper, and have a drink in our dining and lounge area. On the Lotus Club, you will arrive at your destination relaxed and refreshed, even after a long day of travel.
I do want to give a quick disclaimer about that video. No artifacts were harmed in the creating of it. So with all that being said, where do you actually go to get started at? How do you actually get started? In my experience, simply getting started tends to be the most difficult obstacle or challenge in doing something new or different, especially if it's something that might be outside your skill set or outside your wheelhouse. And all I have to say to that is the easiest way to get started is by simply doing it. Jump into the pool and start swimming. As Walt Disney once said, the way to get started is to quit talking and begin doing. And I think that is the perfect quote in order to get started with something new. Because the more you talk about doing something, the less you're going to do it. And I do say that from experience. So, what exactly can be an online program? In essence, almost anything that you feel will connect and engage with visitors. Take a look at your current programs and see which ones you can adapt into a virtual online format. We did one with our Working on the Railroad programs, as I mentioned throughout this presentation. Also, take a look at your artifacts, your collections, or even your site to see what kind of online videos you can create. Spotlight them, highlight them, make 2 or 3 minute long videos about them. And if you don't think you have anything that would translate well into a virtual format, why not think of doing something new built entirely for the virtual world? Do a behind the scenes tour. Also think about what visitors can and cannot see at your site and consider doing something to show off the more inaccessible parts. Your archives, collections areas, restoration area if you have one, things that visitors may not really get to see when visiting your site. Also work with local partners, communities, and related organizations to create something unique and different. Like we're planning on doing with the Wernersville train station next month. And also just think outside the box. As one of the great aspects of creating online content and doing virtual programs is that you have the freedom to create something or to present something that you might not be able to do at your site or in person. You can create something entirely new for the virtual world. Now I've talked about the how and the why, so let's talk about the what. What are you going to need to get started with your own virtual programs or online content? Well, you certainly need an idea or an existing program to adapt virtually, but there's a little bit more to it than that. Some things that you'll need are going to be a camera, a computer, internet access, microphone, tripod, video, audio, or maybe even photo editing software. And that's just some of the basics. And a lot of these things you can get for free or relatively low cost. And if you're serious about doing this kind of work and getting these programs started, then you will need to have a willingness to not only try something new, but to learn something new. YouTube tutorials are a great resource to learning how to use different video editing programs, learning which programs will best suit your needs, and to see the kind of videos other museums are putting out there, so you can steal or take inspiration from other sites. Now, all that might actually sound a little expensive and possibly difficult to justify the cost of, especially to your board, but there are plenty of resources out there that you can use for free or very low cost. So what are these resources? Isn't video editing work in and of itself expensive? Surely I won't be able to create quality videos with something that's free, right? Video editing programs can certainly be expensive. After all, my copy of Sony Vegas is about $250 to $300 on sale, but there are plenty of free programs out there that will allow you to create videos of equal quality to those made on Sony Vegas or on Adobe Premiere. Because it's not necessarily the program that will determine the quality of your video, but the content in it and how it's presented. Sure, different programs will offer different things and will be able to do more or less than other programs, but essentially it's going to boil down to the content in your video or in your program. So what are some of these resources that we can all use for free or for low cost? Well, there are your basic tools and resources, which most of us probably use on a daily basis in one way or another. These things are going to be a smartphone. I'm sure we all have one or know somebody who has one, and I'm willing to bet that they all have video recording capabilities to them. So if you don't have a camcorder or a digital camera that can record video, use your smartphone, as that will be able to take high quality footage of whatever you need to film, and you'll have the majority of work done for you. Also, computer and internet access. We all use these each and every day, from admission sales to group tour reservations to email. And if you have a computer and internet access and are attending this particular conference, then you also have access to Zoom, which we're all using right now. And what makes Zoom great is that it's free and easy to use, not only for a presenter, but also for an audience member. And this is what we've been using to stream our own live virtual programs for the past 2 years. Another good resource that might be a little overlooked is your Windows 10 video editor. This is a very basic and bare bones video editor that comes standard on every copy of Windows 10. It's super easy to use and put together some very basic videos on. It doesn't have all the bells and whistles that other programs do, but if you're just starting out and want to make some very simple videos for your museum, this is a great program to get started with and to get you familiar with using video editing programs in general. On a more advanced level, there are various free programs out there that will help you in creating more complex videos and can do more things than your basic Windows video editor can, such as custom graphics, better transitions, text, image overlays, all that kind of stuff. Now, full disclosure, of the programs I'm about to list, I have used all but one of these for at least one project or another, either for my own time or for the museum. In terms of video resources, you're going to have programs such as Kaden Live, OpenShot, Shotcut, Olive, and the Sumo.app suite. For audio recordings, there are Audacity and Sumo.app. And if you're doing any kind of photo editing, resources that I've been using have been things like Photopea, GIMP, and the Sumo.app suite. Now, all these programs are free to use and free to download. Some might have a cost associated with them, but that price is mainly for unlocking some premium features that you're never going to use, or to help support the developers. All in all, each of these programs is free to use and free to download. They are also all super, super simple to use, very user-friendly, and very, very easy to learn. Now, Photopea and the Sumo.app are the only two programs that are completely web-based and can be used in your browser of choice. The rest, however, are available on Windows, Linux, and some are available on macOS. Now, if you're looking to get started with purchasing some equipment, here are three items that you can buy that will cost you less than $150, with the most expensive thing on here being the first item: a stabilizing smartphone gimbal. Now, everything here are things that we at Railroad Museum have used or use something like it when doing our own virtual programs or creating our own online content. The gimbals themselves will help you in capturing or streaming stable video and allows you to control the motion of your phone. An LED video light like this one has been super helpful to us in illuminating dark corners of our equipment, but may not be a necessity for everyone depending on what you'd be planning on doing. These can be found for as cheap as $15 on Amazon. Finally, the last two items are two different kinds of microphones. The first one being a wireless lavalier mic that can clip onto your collar or your shirt, while the second one can be plugged directly into your audio jack on your phone or camera directly. Either one of these will be a necessity for capturing clear audio when doing streams from your phone or capturing video with a camcorder. Both of these are around $40 each, and there are lavalier microphones that can be found on Amazon that plug directly into your audio jack for as low as $12. It's all going to depend on what you think you're going to need. Now, don't let your lack of experience in this area or lack of equipment deter you from working on virtual programs or creating online content, because to be quite honest with you all, you really don't need any experience to get started with all this. Sure, it can certainly feel overwhelming and potentially daunting, especially with everything that you might need to learn or everything that goes into making the videos or everything that you need to buy, but it does not have to be. Don't feel overwhelmed just because it might be something new or different, because 90% of your work is already done for you. The fact that you already have a smartphone, a computer, programs at your site that you already created to be given in person, and just by having ideas in your head, you've already done the majority of work for these videos. That last 10% is just a willingness to learn and to try something new and just getting started with it. And when you start with what you have, your basic tools and resources, your smartphone, Zoom, Windows 10 video editor, in order to create your videos. And when you're just beginning, create simple videos, because oftentimes creating simple videos is going to be a lot better than trying to create more complex ones. And depending on the topic or the length of your video, it really does not need to be all that complex. And as you begin to create more videos and feel like this is an avenue in which you are serious about getting into and continuing on, then start looking into getting better equipment and creating more complex videos. Build yourself up, because if you buy everything all at once, your cameras, lights, tripods, microphones, all that kind of stuff, you might find that creating these videos and creating these virtual programs is just taking up too much of your time, or they're just too much work. Or you might find that the equipment that you bought just isn't something that you need. And so now, spend all that money on equipment that's just going to be an expensive paperweight and sit around. So look into what you need or think you might need and buy better equipment over time if you feel it's necessary. And finally, focus on the quality of your videos over the quantity of them. Don't rush to try and put out multiple videos a week or in a month, because that's not going to be fair to you, your staff, your audience, your visitors, or to the reputation of your museum. Your audiences and your visitors are not going to care about what you use to create your videos. As long as the content for your video is good, presented well, and shows that care went into creating it, your audiences are going to see that. Whether it was put together on a smartphone in Windows Movie Maker, or you are using a 4K camera in Premiere, your audiences will care more about the content than what it was made on. And finally, what kind of benefits can you expect by creating these virtual programs and sharing this content online with the world? More importantly, why should you really consider continuing these programs well after the closure period has ended? And many, if not all of us, I'm sure at this point, have fully reopened.
Recording in progress.
In my opinion, the biggest benefit that will come out from not only creating virtual programs and sharing your content online, but will also continue to be your biggest benefit, even after reopening, is accessibility. Museums have always seemed to struggle with accessibility, whether that is accessibility to their site, to their collections, or even to the staff. Museums have always seemed to struggle with this obstacle. Fortunately, we live in an age where global communication is instant, and every single one of us can talk to somebody on the other side of the world instantaneously. Content is being shared online each and every day through YouTube, Twitch, Facebook Live, and so many other platforms, and is being seen by people all over the world. So now, by putting your content online and creating these virtual programs, your museum is now no longer being seen by tourists in your area or by your local communities, but by people all over the world. You are reaching new audiences, and you're allowing people who cannot access your museum or experience your programming to finally be able to do so. And it's not just the global reach in which you're now more accessible, but you can now show off the more inaccessible parts of your museum. You can show off what goes on behind the scenes in your archives and collections area. You can show and allow your visitors and the general public to see more of your museum than they would get to by simply visiting it. In addition to that, your museum will become more accessible to people with disabilities, those with vision or hearing loss, the ones with mobility issues, as well as those who cannot afford the drive or the Uber or the bus fare, or have no access to public transportation, or cannot afford the admission rate to finally be able to experience your museum. In the words of Sir Tim Berners-Lee, the inventor of the World Wide Web, the power of the web is in its universality. Access by everyone, regardless of disability, is an essential aspect. And that's what we are aiming to do with virtual programs and online content in the museum world in the 21st century. Now, as I was putting this presentation together, I was kind of curious as to where our audiences were tuning in from for our various Zoom programs that we did over the past 2 years. So this map just represents about 300 people that bought tickets and attended one of our Zoom programs. And as you can see, our audience wasn't just from Pennsylvania, though that is where the majority tuned in from, but also New York, Connecticut, Virginia, Florida, Washington, Arizona, California, all over the continental United States. Now, sure, this doesn't represent all of our Zoom programs that we've done, but it does show how far our programs were reaching, even if it was just one person from Washington or one family from Arizona. We were still reaching new audiences all across the country. Another benefit is going to be enhancing the value of your museum. In the very early days of the pandemic, I heard from a lot of different museums that they were very reluctant to put out any kind of online content or virtual programs, because the thought was that if we're now offering all this stuff online for free, isn't that going to devalue our museum? And why would people continue to come to our museums if they can get all this stuff online? Now, that's definitely a valid concern, but having your content online is not going to devalue your collection or your museum. It's not going to prevent visitors from visiting your site or make what each and every one of you does any less valuable. As museums begin to change and to adapt to the 21st century, diving into the unknown can be scary, but online content and virtual programs are not going to devalue your museum or your collection, but rather it's going to enhance it. Not only are you being more accessible and reaching audiences all around the globe, but creating these virtual programs can also give you a chance to work collaboratively with other institutions, whether they are similar in scope, such as the Railroad Museum of Pennsylvania and the California State Railroad Museum, or if they are two completely different sites, like Eastern State Penitentiary and the Erie Maritime Museum. These collaborative efforts will help you in making new connections with other museums and might get you to look at some of your artifacts in your collection a little differently. In addition to working collaboratively, your virtual programs can also bring in donations to your museum. When we first started doing these virtual programs, we originally had a flat ticket rate. Over time, as we did more, we learned that we were bringing in more money and selling more tickets when we switched to a pay what you wish donation model. This allowed our visitors and audiences to determine the value of our programs through donations rather than us assigning a value to our programs. And in the end, we felt that this was not only the better of the two models, but that those who were attending these programs were there because they saw the value of these programs. And finally, another way this is going to enhance your museum is that, in essence, this is free advertising. You're advertising yourselves online through this content. And so when rail fans in England are watching YouTube videos of trains, they might see a video from Railroad Museum and click on it. Or someone might be doing research on the American Revolution and stumble across a video from the Museum of the American Revolution in Philadelphia, or from the Daniel Boone Homestead in Berks County. And now, without really spending anything, your videos have reached someone new somewhere else in the world. That concludes my presentation. I just want to quickly thank everybody for joining in this morning. This is my contact information right here. If you have any questions, you can always reach me at c-chobryan@pa.gov or give me a call at 717-687-8628, extension 3003. And before I answer any questions, these are a list of a couple of museum YouTubes to visit that I think do a phenomenal job at creating online content for their sites. Of course, you have us, Railroad Museum in Strasbourg. There's also the Antique Automobile Club of America in Hershey, the Andy Warhol Museum in Pittsburgh, Mutter Museum in Philly, and President Buchanan's Wheatland Lancaster History here in Lancaster. And again, that concludes my presentation. If anybody has any questions, I will be happy to answer them at this time.
Thank you, Chris. I have a couple of questions that have come up here in the chat. One from Ellen Enslow at Chester County History Center about how did you advertise your virtual programs? They've had success with Eventbrite, but did you use something different?
We definitely used Eventbrite for our ticketing. And along with Eventbrite, we also advertised our virtual programs through Facebook and Instagram, as well as sending out email blasts to our members.
And a question from Amy Hammond at the State Museum. You said you were, you know, trying to figure out what the best time and day was for your audience. How did you get at that? And what day and time ended up working best for your programs?
I think it really depended on the programs that we were putting on, but I think, if I recall correctly, the best time and day that worked for us, especially for our behind the scenes programs, those were definitely the ones that were more popular when we were doing all these virtual programs over the pandemic. I think in terms of time of day, we definitely found that doing our behind the scenes programs work best usually around 6:30, 7 o'clock. I think 7 o'clock was the time that we usually did all of our programs that we found worked best because people are just getting off of work at that by that time. They're just finishing up dinner. They're just getting home. So figure 7 o'clock is probably the perfect time for people to finally get ready, sit down, and kind of watch our behind the scenes tours. As far as day, I think for the most part, we did these on Wednesdays and Thursdays, which for some reason worked out best for us. I think we did them on Fridays. We were afraid that people were going to be going out on a Friday night, and we didn't want to compete with people going out and partying.
Question here from Kristen from the Trolley Museum, PA Trolley Museum in Washington. She's curious about your staffing levels at the Railroad Museum. And did you have staffing changes during the pandemic?
We did have some staffing change during the pandemic. Unfortunately, during the last half of the pandemic, a lot of us got put on partial furlough. So our associate group, in which many of the staff at the museum are employed through, were put on partial furlough. So we weren't working 5 days a week five days a week every week. We were now working 3 days a week every week So we got 2 days in which we were furloughed. So that did change a little bit. And so in terms of working, you know, which staff was working, it definitely changed. As far as our staffing level, we have in our visitor services department, as of right now, five of us actually. One is about to retire, but there's four of us who work full-time. We currently only have one educator, and we have one person up in our archives and one person down in our collections area. And these were the departments that were really doing the bulk of these videos and these virtual programs.
Yeah, Amy Hammond was asking, what was the role of the staff member who did the editing? Was it an educator or an IT person?
It was not an educator. It was not an IT person. The person doing the bulk of the editing was me. And I'm a visitor services associate at the museum. So my role is essentially giving tours to visitors, interacting with visitors, interpreting our equipment, selling tickets at the admission desk, basically being a jack of all trades. I kind of took on editing because, as well as filming for these programs, just because I was one of the few, if not the only person, somewhat knowledgeable with video editing programs.
Well, if anybody else has any questions and would like to unmute and ask Chris personally, feel free. We have a few more minutes if anybody has any other questions, or if I missed any going through the chat. Chris has posted his email address in the chat if you want to follow up with any questions too. Okay, well, hearing none, thank you, Chris, for your time and energy putting this presentation together. A lot of great free resources shared there and good experience. It never hurts to have somebody to call when you're trying to do something you've never done before. So now we all know somebody to call. I want to thank everybody for attending this last session of the morning. Every one of the links that was shared in our email is specific to a particular Zoom. So you'll have to scroll down in your email for this afternoon's Zoom links. They are different from this morning's. I hope we see you back here at 1 o'clock with Chad Barger. He's going to be talking about fundraising and monthly giving. So we'll hope to see some of you back here then. Thanks again, Chris, and thanks everyone. We'll talk to you all soon. Bye now.